Welcome to the Irishman, Englishman and Scotsman Football Podcast. Hello and welcome to another episode of the Irishman, Englishman and Scotsman Football Podcast. This is part three of our away day confession segment. Joining me tonight are the Manchester City fans. We're going to start off with Gareth. How are you doing, Gareth?
Not too bad. How are you keeping, Jimmy?
Good, good. Well, I'm a Newcastle fan, so things could be a lot better. If only we had the Manchester City money. Gareth, I'm going to ask you your favourite away venue, please.
I mean, there's quite a few, you know. Three I picked out, I suppose. One being Anfield, which a lot of people would be surprised to say, given our rivalry with Liverpool. But the reason why I picked Liverpool away is because it's one of very few grounds that puts the away fans on the lower tier, close to the pitch. Anybody who travels there will know what I mean. Most stadiums you go to in the UK now or England, they put you on a top tier, up away, so you make as less noise as possible. So Liverpool away for the atmosphere being so close to pitch. And the other two I picked out, PSG and Madrid in Europe, because basically the home fans are so fanatic and the passion they have and the lighting system and all that kind of stuff. So them three for different reasons, I suppose.
Good stuff. Yeah, I've been to Paris and Madrid, cracking stadiums. And your least favourite away venue, Gareth?
Least favourite. Well, don't forget, us Manchester City fans had the trouble of travelling all the way through Division 2. York City, Swansea, Swindon, we've done them all. So, you know, two of the worst ones, I think, would be Everton or Fulham for me. Everton is a real cram. It's horrible. And Fulham, they have a section where it's like a mixed section that makes the home and the away supporters, which I don't like that either. Yeah, but Watford is another one. It's very crammed as well. Not great. Three, I suppose, are put in the same category. Just not really particularly nice travels.
You're not the first person to bring up Goodison Park because of the restricted view as well, I think is a problem.
Yeah.
And your away day story, Gareth?
Yes, I've got a couple.
I'm sure you've got more than a couple, but just tell me one.
Yeah, I've had to restrict it down to ones that I could tell, but I suppose one that made me laugh was when we played Schalke away. I think it was last season. We were 2-0 down in the game, 1-3-2. Sterling scored in the last minute, but What was funny about it was there was guys in the away end serving alcohol. And basically, the way they were doing it was they had a backpack on them and they had a kind of a hose. And if you wanted your drink filled up, you go over and he pours it into your cup and fills it up. So that was going on and on. Everybody was being nice to the guys, paying for them as they go along. But this guy that we had in our end was also drinking his own beer as he was going along in his own mouth watching the match. But when the goal went in for the last goal, Sterling's goal went in, the away end erupted. It was manic. Everybody piled on the guys that were serving the drink, start pressing the button themselves, start pouring the hose into their own mouth. I'd say the guy was done out of a job by the end of the day because there wasn't a drop of beer left. They were pouring on top of each other's heads and squirting at each other, everything. Very funny story. But
right, Gareth, before we move on to Eddie, can you just quickly tell me about GH Memorabilia?
Yeah, GH Memorabilia is my own personal page. It's basically a page. We just sell all sorts of sport memorabilia. It's my own company. We also run celebrity nights where we get ex-players over from all various clubs, Manchester United, Liverpool, Celtic, City. We host events in Ireland, such as, you know, meet and greet events, events with the Premier League trophy, Champions League trophy, and events like that. So if that's of any use or if anybody's looking for anything, that kind of thing in Ireland, by all means, log onto the page and get in touch, you know.
Just tell us what the page is called, Gareth, and how they can find you once again.
It's GH Memorabilia. It's on Facebook. Very simple. It's a memorabilia page. So it's a like page. Just like it. If you're looking for a birthday present, a Christmas present, or anything like that, drop us a message, you know.
And all sorts of sports, football, rugby, boxing, everything, is it?
All sorts of sports, yeah. And we also host events on a yearly basis whenever we can go back to doing it with ex-players from all various football clubs and boxers and rugby stars and all that kind of stuff. So we're always putting on sporting events.
Brilliant, good stuff. Thanks a million. Eddie, you're in Manchester, are you?
Yeah, in Manchester, yeah. Rainy Manchester.
Right, rainy Manchester. Rainy Europe, I think, at the minute. Eddie, you must have a lot of stories to tell as well. What's your favourite away venue?
Well, I'm 62. Well, I'm 62 now, so I've been to a hell of a lot. One's got to be Lokeren.
Belgium, yeah.
Yeah, because that's in the middle of it. It seems to be in a forest. I love that. I think, like the other lads, obviously Madrid, but it's other places, I suppose, even going to places like Kharkiv with Shakhtar. They've become favourites because not everybody gets the chance to go there. And it's, and these lads will tell you, it's a different world altogether when you go. So, and we've always been welcome there, whatever, you know. The away end's full of nice plush seats. That's not a bad place to go and have a nice weekend. Yeah, there's a few, but, you know, it's one of those. There's a lot of stadiums like Palace. They need, I'm 6 foot five, so Palace is a nightmare. If these lads are struggling, you know, I am. So, yeah. Yeah, I've been to most the big European sides, but they've all got history with them. So it's very hard to say your favourite, because all the new grounds we go to, invariably, so we're in Europe that much now, we seem to repetitively go, occasionally we'll throw up a good one where us lads can go to where we've never been for, and they're the enjoyable ones.
Yeah, so you prefer Ukraine to London. And your least favourite, Eddie?
Oh, God, least favourite. I've got a few. Well, one of them, and I don't think everybody agree with me, is the San Siro, only because we're in the year 2009 and it still looks like it's in the backwaters. The toilets for the ladies, they're a hole in the ground. That's ridiculous. So the San Siro, the old Stadium Camanel at Juventus back in 76, that was a nightmare after the game. And then Hamburg, where the coach we were on forgot us and drove off and left us outside the stadium. So, you know.
Nice guy.
But what I would say is going with these lads, it's a pleasure, because we always, you know, we have a drink, but we're sensible. I mean, I don't know if they told you about Madrid and the glass. I mean, I don't like heights, but we were 27 floors up there, and there's a glass in this hotel, there's a glass you walk over. So you look down on the street. Some people were crawling over it, and they'd not had a drink.
So, yeah, I wouldn't like that. I'm not good with the heights myself. The Bernabeu is a nice stadium, though, I have to say. I used to have a season ticket at Malaga back in the days when it was 200 euro for a season ticket. There was no seats. You could walk over people's heads with a glass bottle of alcohol-free beer. I've seen Beckham's first goal down there, but even though you had a season ticket, when Madrid and Barcelona came to town, it was an extra 40 quid. Right, Eddie, you must have a load of stories. Give me your away day confession there, your best away story.
Oh, God, my best away story. I think, to be honest, for me, the away games, it's like Madrid last year. It seems a lifetime ago again. You know, we get there and we need a result and we go behind and then we come and win. And the worst thing about that was, because it was such a great night for all the lads that were there. And like Gareth says, we've been to the Halifax of this world and losing in the FA Cup. And that's the beauty about City fans. Whatever, proper City fans, we never crow about how well we're doing, because we've been like so many clubs, we've struggled. So we appreciate these times. I think going to the grounds and enjoying the games. And I think when you go to a game like Madrid and you win, and just what I was going to try to say was, and it was all set up for the return leg, where we just cleared UEFA and the ground was going to be bouncing. There were going to be banners against UEFA, such as, and then it all got took away, sadly, with COVID, and no people have died. So I'm not being selfish. People have passed away, and we will get football back. But that was going to be such a tremendous night. But nights like Madrid, you cannot beat them.
Yeah, hopefully they'll come back again sooner rather than later. Eddie, quickly tell me, please, about MCF Memorial, because it's a fantastic story to tell.
We have a memorial garden at the Etihad, where people are allowed to put the loved ones' ashes. My dad passed away just as we moved into the Etihad. So I decided about 7 years ago to, I had like Gareth quite a big following on Facebook. So I thought, why don't I do a memorial page for City fans? Because we hear about United and all sort of players that pass on, with respect, they go on the tally, we understand that. But when players pass, fans pass, that have been the lifeblood, I thought, let's do something for them. Put my dad on, someone else. And there's been, up to press now, I've raised just over £30,000, I think.
Wow.
And what I do is, basically, when I have my charity nights, unlike Gareth, I get a lot of ex-players come on the nights, and they support me. And on those nights, I do things for the Battle Back Centre, and they'll support me. And because they've closed because of COVID, they have got a lot of City stock, and it's all legit. So what I do is, I advertise it, people come online and buy it all over the world, and Gareth has helped me. And then I get a percentage. And what I do is, with that percentage, not for me personally, with that percentage, I then give it to a chosen charity. And then when I post what that charity's had in the receipts, so everybody knows. The latest one I started last week is for Colin Bell's, in Colin Bell's memory, for a primary school that he was very close to. So that's my next album in memory of Colin.
That's absolutely brilliant, Eddie. Fair play to you. And what's the full name?
It's called MCFC Memorial, Let's Not Forget Past Blues. It's free to join. It's on Facebook, and if you Google it, it'll come up. And if anybody wants any city memorabilia, it's 100% legit, signed, comes with a COA. And also the guy I work with, he's a Manchester United fan. I think United stuff, so I know I shouldn't be saying this, lads, but if it helps a charity, I'm well. And same as you, Gareth. If it helps a charity, I'll do it. Just go on, contact me on the Facebook, we'll ask to join, and you're more than welcome.
MCFC Memorial, Let's Not Forget Past Blues. Eddie, fair play to you. You're a saint.
No, it's just, it's a passion of mine. But well, thank you. Still,
there's a lot of people could learn from that. Stephen, finally got around to you.
Yeah, how are you, JB?
I'm good, good, good. I'm a busy man.
Yeah.
You've obviously been with the guys, been all over Europe, been all over to the lower league grounds. And that's another beautiful thing about City I never really thought about. People think about them as a, you know, a billionaire club and they got all the money. You know, personally speaking, I can't wait for the day Newcastle are sold, but City had the run of bad days. Like, I know Trevor, for example, was the only Man City fan I knew growing up, and the old brother shirts in the days of Steve Lomas and Georgie Hinkladze. You know, these guys, when basically they were kind of what Newcastle are now. So, I mean, it's good that you guys haven't forgotten your roots and what basically, you know.
We've been there, done that all, yeah.
Yeah, and you're, you know, probably win the league again this season. Right, Stephen, what's your favourite away venue?
In favour of the way, well, for me, it's all about atmosphere and, you know, memories, not about bricks and mortar. So I loved the Bernabeu when we won last year. It was the atmosphere there was brilliant, but nothing is going to top. I know the stadium might be fantastic. Brighton away when we won the league the last day of the season. The atmosphere that day was just unbelievable. So that is a favourite of mine now because of that.
And yeah. your least favourite, Stephen?
My least favourite it's not around anymore, but it has to be Highbury. The away end in Highbury, I didn't like it. It was no good. The only thing I took from the game, and we lost the game as well, which didn't help, but the game I went to see them was that, do you remember the penalty with Perez and Henry?
I do, yeah. They made an absolute fool of themselves, didn't they?
Yeah, it was that game, and that was in front of the away end. So we had a great laugh about that. They were 1-0 up and they went on to win, but that was the memory I took from that game.
Brilliant. Right, Steve, and your favourite away, you've got an away story from your away day confession?
Yeah, it was when we were playing Atalanta in the San Siro, we were in Milan, and myself and Darren and Gareth there were walking down the road the night before the game, and we noticed a Man City bus outside the hotel. And we said, oh, they must be staying in that hotel, like, you know. And sure enough, there was three big, burly-looking lads at the door. I said, oh, it must be the bouncers. So I wasn't going to let that opportunity pass me. So I said, I'm going up and going in. Gareth took out his phone and started filming me. He said, this would be a great laugh. I walked up as if I owned the hotel. The boys got to one side, and then I walked straight in. I said, I better not stop now. So where's the bar? I sniffed out where the bar was. And I went with, and who was in there? Only Aguero, Gundogan, Mendy was there, and all not drinking Coke or whatever, but with all the staff. I had a great 2 hours in there with all the players. And I rang Gareth and he followed me in and said, just be cool, come on in. So we had a great 2 hours with the players and that. So that was my away day memory.
Brilliant. And they were all chatting away to you, no hassle at all, yeah?
Oh, they were brilliant. Sergio came over and I got Gareth to show him. Gareth has a brilliant tattoo on him. Of that day in 2012 when he got that goal and pulled the jersey over his head. Gareth has that, so we showed Sergio that and he started calling over people then, and that was brilliant. That was a memory.
Wow, great stuff.
Just to say, JP, just to come in there for a second, the reason why I was recording Stephen and I was laughing at was because he was absolutely pissed drunk. And I said to the other lad, I said to Darren, I said there's absolutely no fucking chance that he's getting into a 5-star hotel where the players are staying. He couldn't walk in a straight line.
Pure luck or pure Dutch courage or pure ball, Stephen, huh?
That's it. Yeah, you got a chance at it. Yeah.
Right, guys. Thanks a lot. You've been absolutely brilliant. Manchester City fans, Eddie and Gareth, I linked those pages in the comment section, and they'll also be available on our social media sites, GH Memorabilia and MCFC Memorial. Let's not forget Past Blues. Thanks a lot, lads. Cheers. So next up on our away day confessions, Manchester City fans, we have Paul in Manchester. Paul, how you doing, buddy?
I'm doing well, thanks. How are you?
Good, good, good. Still under lockdown, but making the best of it. Okay, Paul, the first question I'm going to ask you is, what's your favourite away day venue as a Man City fan?
The one in the UK that I really did like to go to, still do, is Villa Park. It's just got a great atmosphere, old stadium, great memories, two FA Cup semi-final wins from when my younger days in 69 and late, and then in 81 again. It just brings back great memories, and I love the ground.
Yeah, I forgot they used to hold a lot of FA Cup semi-finals there. Even up to the 90s, I think they might have done it. Old Trafford was a venue, and also Villa Park. Also, and they've got a half-decent team now as well.
Half-decent. Not fully decent, but half-decent.
Not Man City level. Okay. No. Right. Paul, and your least favourite away venue?
Oh, that was a tough one to think about. It's also in the Midlands. I have really bad memories of coming out of the Hawthorns.
West Brom.
Yeah, that's right. So I came out of the Hawthorns once, and we absolutely got bricked, literally, stones and bricks thrown at us. I remember the exact year, it was 1977. And we're coming out of the ground, it's the bad old days of football when hooliganism was not at its peak, because it got even worse at some point. And we're coming out of there, and these West Brom fans, we've been kept behind, as often was the case. And as we're coming out of the ground, these West Brom hooligans start throwing stones and bricks at us. The police did sweet FA. I don't know what language I'm allowed to use just now, but
whatever you feel comfortable with, Paul.
Sweet fuck all then, but to protect us. So the stones and the bricks were coming in at us, and all you could do was put your hands over your head and cover your head to protect yourself. Fortunately, didn't get hit, but there were some people who were cut. So nasty place. I'm not saying all West Brom fans like that. I know every club's got its minority of fans that do that, but it was just not a great experience from there.
So it was good to get out of there unscathed. Okay, Paul, and you must have an away day story, an away day confession for me.
Oh, I've got a few away day confessions. This one might sound like I'm showing off a bit, but I always try to take in one away European tie every season, City get away, at least one if I can. Clearly can't do it at the moment. My favourite was when we went to the Bernabeu for the semi-final against Real Madrid 3-4 years ago now. We lost it 1-0. But what a day that was. You know, you stood, it's the whole atmosphere. You stood in the square drinking beers with your mates and having some tapas as you do in Spain. And then you get to the ground and the atmosphere is just fantastic. We'd drawn the first leg 0-0. We generally thought we had a chance. I got interviewed for Sky TV. So this is all part of the evening. So about 7 o'clock or whatever the time was, Sky TV approached me and said, can we have an interview with you? We'll talk about... you know, the game's coming up, what do you feel about it? And I said, of course you can, I don't mind chatting. So this interview goes out and he's chatting for about 2-3 minutes and I said, well, will that be shown? He said, yeah, no problem. Later, when I got back home, they showed about 10 seconds of it. So that was, you know, cutting it back to the bare necessities, or it didn't like what I'd said. But then the whole evening, going to the ground, just being a City fan from back in the 60s and thinking, would I ever see City in a major tournament, in a major ground, and then actually having the chance to do it was just wonderful. And the whole atmosphere that evening, despite the fact we lost 1-0, was just fantastic. I think a lot of City supporters did go there thinking, we'll probably lose, but we don't care, because that's the way we are.
Were you actually sober for the interview, Paul?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, reasonably sober. I wouldn't say I would have passed a breathalyzer, but I knew what I was saying.
Yeah, I have to say, though, fair play to Man City fans. And you're not the first one to say this, but I know a lot of you, you know, you don't forget where you came from. City were in the lower leagues and fought their way through. The younger generation of fans now will look at City and think, just a rich club. But, you know, they've had to grind and come through all the bad days, you know. And, yeah, I mean, it's great that you guys still remember that. Okay, thank you very much, Paul. Right, Nigel. Now, Nigel, another diehard Man City fan. But Nigel is also the host of the Manchester City Show podcast, the Man City Show podcast. Nigel, tell me all about that before I ask you for your confessions.
Yeah, well, it's been going for about 9 or 10 years. We're a group of City fans. We get together every week And we talk all things Man City. It's been described as the Daily Telegraph of podcasts. You know, it's not none of your riffraff. You know, I have, you've just been listening from Paul. I think you're going to be hearing from Roger as well on this show, and he's a regular guest of mine. So now we get some great guests, and what a fantastic time we're having at the moment talking about the great Man City.
Yeah, you are flying at the minute. I think you're champions elect now, and no one in their right mind would disagree with me right now. Where can we find you? If our listeners, where can we find the Man City Show podcast?
Well, in usual places, you can find your podcast. We're also on Twitter as well. We're at City Podcast if you want to follow us on Twitter. We've got a Facebook page as well. But yeah, where you'd find your usual podcast, we will be there. And it's called The Man City Show.
Brilliant stuff. By the way, folks, if you are listening, we'll share that on our social media, and we'll also put that in the comment section on our YouTube channel. Okay, Nigel, down to business. Man City games, what is your favourite away venue?
It's difficult. I've got a few, so I'm going to throw a few in just for comment just on the way, if that's okay. And two of them, actually, I've got mixed feelings. I kind of love them and hate them. A fantastic sports arena, a fantastic football ground is St. James's Park. Magnificent.
Yes. Thank you for saying that.
Unusual venue in the middle of the city centre, as you will know. But where they sit you is right up in, as you know, the away fans.
In the gods, yeah.
You need oxygen masks up there to see it, and binoculars. So I suppose I kind of love it as a stadium, but kind of hate it as a fan. The other one is actually Crystal Palace, Selhurst Park. Really old ground, sort of you can sit there and bang the corrugated iron walls to sort of get a bit more atmosphere. You're stuck in the corner. There's kind of pylons sort of blocking your view and all that stuff. But actually, it's got a great atmosphere as well. But the one I'm going to pick, I'm going to go European as well. I'm going to show off a bit as well and actually talk about Monaco. Because as Paul said, it's not just the game, it's the atmosphere, it's the build-up, it's the going abroad, it's seeing people at the airport and walking along the beach in Nice and sitting in a bar in your sky blue shirt and seeing old mates. It's that whole build-up to the game. Just to remind you, this was March 2017, of course, and the first leg. It was 5-3 at the Etihad, and City then went and lost 3-1 at Monaco, making it 6-6 on aggregate, and City losing on away goals. So in terms of the game, it was an absolute disaster. But yeah, I think going to an away ground, going to somewhere new, and just that whole atmosphere of Blues together abroad is just very, very special. I think it's difficult to capture that anywhere else. There are no other contenders for the lease. It is the worst place on the planet to watch football. It's horrendous. It is horrendous. It is it is not a football stadium. It's an athletic stadium. And it's the London Stadium. And it is the worst place. West Ham United's new ground. Used to love Upton Park. Lovely little ground. Great atmosphere. But the London Stadium is horrendous. Again, you are stood between a running track and rows and rows of spaces before you even get to the pitch. I was there I've been there, I think, four times to see City. They've not been there that long. And there was one game where genuinely I hadn't realised we'd scored. It was that far away. That was at the other end from where we were. And I struggled to see that. I know I've got a few more grey hairs than a few of you. I've been around the block a few times. I genuinely couldn't see the ball going in the net. It's a horrendous place to watch football. And they should have done what City did, of course. You'll know that the City of Manchester Stadium had a running track originally, but it was planned in a way to dig that out, to go down another 9-10 metres, whatever it is, to create a pitch where the fan put another layer of the seating in, another row of seating in, to get fans close to the pitch. So it's a football ground. West Ham United's London Stadium is horrendous.
Wow, good stuff, Nigel. Finno, who's a co-host of mine on the podcast, is a big West Ham fan, and he won't be too happy to hear that. But I know what you mean about, you know, the running track, those Olympic kind of style stadiums. Rapid Vienna, where Austria also play the national, the teams play up there. National team plays in Vienna in the Ernst Happelwald Stadium is the same. And you go in there as an away fan and you're out in the gods, and, you know, you can't really even see the goals, you know, because there's this big, stupid track in between. And yeah, I totally understand you.
JP, I'd be interested to know what your mate thinks as a West Ham fan, what he thinks about going there. That's me as an away fan. I'd be really interested to know what his view is about it themselves. Has he ever discussed it, the view that this space of the running track still there?
No, he hasn't mentioned it, but it's definitely going to be a topic we'll speak about now in the future after that, Nigel. You know, a lot of people have picked Everton because of the restricted area so far. obviously Millwall for obvious reasons. I've heard about Newcastle because of the obviously the height and you're up in the gods, drink being a negative thing, but you're definitely the first one to say West Ham. Nigel, you must have a juicy away day confession for me.
I've got a few, but I've picked one that we all will have spent time trawling the internet, sort of talking to mates, trying to find tickets in the city end. And there are times when, of course, you can't. And, of course, rather naughtily, we know someone from the opposing fans or we managed to buy one from somebody, let's just say. So this was 2004, February 2004, the FA Cup replay. The first game had finished 11 days earlier, 1-1 in Manchester, and City went to Tottenham Hotspur for the fourth round replay of the FA Cup that year. And I had to get a ticket behind the goal, the opposite goal to where the City fans were, sitting with the Spurs fans. And of course, as you do, sit on your hands, say nothing, stum, nobody knows the difference. And at halftime, you may remember, or if you're not, just to remind you and your listeners, that it was 3-0 to Spurs at halftime. Not only that, but young Joey Barton had a few words with the referee as he left the pitch and was sent off at halftime, not surprisingly. And our star striker, Nicholas Anelka, also had been sort of cropped and disappeared as well. So we came out for the second half with 10 men, without our star striker, 3-0 down. We know what happened then, of course. Sylvain Distan scored. I said nothing. Quiet. Not a word. Second wanting, Paul Bosvelt. Not a word, as the excitement was building. We then got an equaliser. Sean Wright Phillips scored. Not a word. Unfortunately, when the winner went in, John Macken's header, I went ballistic. I lost it. I was out of my seat. I went absolutely crazy in amongst the Spurs fans. And to be fair to them, by then, they'd all kind of put their hands up and said, fair dues, well done, mate, fair dues to you. And there was no trouble whatsoever. They were all kind of shaking me by the hand and congratulating me. I'd managed to keep it going until that winner went in, 3-0 down, 4-3 victory. What a night that was. Something very special.
Brilliant, brilliant. And I didn't know that. I've actually forgot that that Joey Barton was at Man City, because he did spend a few years at Newcastle. Right, Roger, what's your favourite away venue?
Well, if I can say it, my favourite away venue is Wembley. And of course, I'm very long in the tooth, to the extent that I go back to the 60s, 70s, 80s, when if you got one trip a decade to Wembley, you were very lucky. So you can imagine the last 10, 15 years have been absolutely terrific as a City fan, because we've been going there quite regularly. And we've now got in the habit. My best mate is a guy called Nigel, who lives in North London. And what we do is we plan the day so that we drive down, park the car at his house, jump on a tube to Wembley, savour the atmosphere with all the other City fans that we know who are going to the game, enjoy City winning at Wembley, because off the top of my head, I think we've only lost there once or twice in the last 20 years or so. And then we all go back and have a mass Indian celebrating the Wembley win. So it's great. It's a great get together for my daughter, for my son, for Nigel, for, you know, all of us as friends. We all get together. So a fabulous away day.
Brilliant stuff, Roger. A man after my own heart. I absolutely love Indian food, and I can't wait till the Indian restaurants open up again.
Yeah, I agree.
Right, Roger, your least favorite away venue.
Well, the least favorite away venue, I'm afraid to say, fellow City fans, has got to be Anfield. And the reason is because in the 60s and 70s, we used to go there and we'd get turned over every season, come what may. If we got a draw, it was a fabulous result. And it was just awful going to Anfield, knowing that the best you're going to get is a cup of tea for the day. That was it.
Right. And you must have an away day confession from me, Roger.
Yeah, well, I thought this one was quite timely, bearing in mind that City are playing against Borussia Mönchengladbach in a week or so's time. My favourite away venue for the story was going to Borussia Mönchengladbach in 1979. It was the second leg of the quarter-final of the UEFA Cup. We'd drawn 1-1 at Main Road, and we flew out to, I think we flew to Cologne and then got a coach to Mönchengladbach, because it's only quite a small place, Mönchengladbach. The great part of the day was that we actually went to the Holiday Inn and met up with the players before the game, and we're having a chat with the players, who were obviously just chilling out and resting, ready for the game. But then when we got to the ground, we realised that there was 400 City fans all grouped together at the back of the stand that in a ground that held probably about 40,000. This is the old Munching Gladbach ground, not the current one. And after about 20 minutes of the game, the 400 City fans all decided to start singing, "Two World Wars and One World Cup." Whoa. At which point I thought we were going to die. I thought we were going to get killed. Bear in mind, this is only like 30 odd years after the end of the Second World War. And they sang Two World Wars and One World Cup for the rest of the 90 minutes. And I just wish if a hole could have opened up in that stand, I would have been quite happy to go down it. But anyway, we got away with it because we got beat 3-1 as normal. And we were knocked out of the UEFA Cup. That was it.
Well, the Germans, they probably couldn't understand a word you're saying. Maybe that was why you got out of there. Okay.
Maybe so.
Yeah.
That was when Big Malcolm came back, of course, and he played a couple of the kids in a UEFA Cup quarterfinal. Wasn't the right thing to do, I'm afraid, but there you go.
Good stuff. Right, lads, thanks a million. You've been absolutely brilliant. Don't forget, folks, tune in. The Man City Show podcast. You can find it wherever you listen to podcasts. So next up on our away day confessions, Manchester City fans, we have Andrew in Manchester. How are you doing, Andrew?
Doing fine, thank you.
So tell me your favourite away venue, please.
My favourite away venue, which I'm sort of ashamed to admit, is Anfield.
Oh, you're not the first one. Go ahead.
I loved it only because, you know, when you're behind the goal at the away end and you've got the cop facing you, I just enjoyed that. It's like I just thought it was awesome.
Well, is there any particular game that sticks out in your mind, or just Anfield?
I've been Anfield and never won at Anfield when I've been. So, but I have enjoyed the stadium itself.
I think the win on Sunday was Man City's first win at Anfield, maybe since was it 2003?
2003, Nicola Nelka scored. Yes.
Yeah. So it's been a long time.
It has been a while. I've not been to Anfield since, if you like, the City rivalry started. You know, last three or four seasons, the rivalry between City and Liverpool started. I've not been since that started.
But it's never going to be as big as City and United, is it, the rivalry?
Not for me, it's not, no.
No, I don't think so.
No, I'll always hate United more than I hate Liverpool. Maybe that might be a hard word, hate, but I do have hatred towards them, yeah.
Hate in football terms, Andrew, yeah.
Yeah.
And your least favourite away venue as an away fan?
I'd say Crystal Palace.
You're not the first one to say that either. Any particular reason?
Just it's the view now on the side of the pitch, the view from the seats, I don't think it's great. It's very tight as well. Previously, when it was standing, when we were in the corner, the away fans in the corner standing, and no, I just don't think much of it. Plus, we went to the wrong place first. We went to the Crystal Palace near the Athletic Stadium. Instead of Selhurst Park, yeah. We went there first, but then we ended up at Selhurst Park. But, you know, it was a bit of a...
Right, the whole day was a bad experience then, huh?
The whole day was brilliant. To be honest, the whole day was brilliant. The first time I went, before Palace played United in the FA Cup, final 1990, so it was the last game of the season. So that was a good experience, I mean, in that way, but getting there was a pain. And the view wasn't great behind the net, but we got on the pitch at the end and had a laugh with the Palace fans. But recently, in them seats on the side of the pitch, it's a bit tight, you're a bit stuck inside.
Right, yeah, like I said, you're not the first one to pick Palace as a least favourite. And you must have a couple of, or a decent away day confession, Andrew, away day stories.
I've got a couple of stories, yeah. The one that does stick in mind, we went to Tottenham away, like when we were at White Hart Lane. So a group would have come from Withinshaw in Manchester. So we got picked up in a minibus. We went to Asda, got some beer. So we were on the M6 on the way down to London. We broke down in a place called Stone, which is near Stoke. So like there's about six or seven of us. We had to get out, we had to carry our crate of beer. We all had a crate of beer each, or a box of beer, across a farm field, got covered in mud, found this country lane. We ended up getting a bus, luckily enough to get a bus from this lane in Stone to Stoke. We got the train from Stoke to Coventry. When we got to Coventry, my mate had to have a shave, We were only 17 at the time, but he had a beard, bit of a beard. So we had to have a shave to get on the train for the junior, if you like. So then we got the train from Coventry to Euston. Then we got, I think it was an overground train. I can't remember if it was overground or underground, but we went to Seven Sisters Station, which is near Tottenham. Then we had to walk from there to the ground, and then we got there at half time. By that time, we drank all our beer. And me and my mate, he was the youngest out of the group who went, we were only like 70. We had about £1.50 between us, or £1.50 each. So we went to the ground, we got in, they weren't good at that, in the stewards and that. Anyway, we got in, we drew one all. Then we got the train, ended up at Euston anyway. Just got put on the football special with no ticket.
With no ticket?
With no ticket. But there was no check, the police just wanted you to get on the train and out.
Wow, that was some day of travel, huh?
It was a good day. Yeah.
Some day of travel. But I think when you're 17 like that, you don't really care. You don't mind once you get there.
Then when we got back to Piccadilly in Manchester, we had to get on the bus back to Willingshaw. And I was trying to get on the bus for like junior fair. So we started off the day buying beer at Asda and ended up trying to get home as a junior.
So your mate's beard hadn't grown back by the time you got on the way back, no?
No, it has now.
I'm sure it has, right. And that's good stuff, Andrew. Have you got another story for me?
Another one, which was a decent story. As I mentioned about Crystal Palace, last game of the season.
Mm-hmm.
Years and years ago, we drew 2-1, and it was just before they played United in the cup final. So we got a minibus, same group of lads it was, different minibus. And we ended up near the athletic stadium, like I said, and there was only about 4 of us in the back of this minibus. So we were in the beer garden. It was a red hot day. So we got the beer garden table and chairs and got it in the back of our van. So we all sat round that, apart from the driver and a couple of lads in the front. So we had this beer garden chair. Then we got beer, obviously. Ended up near Crystal Palace. But we're driving through London with a side door of the transit open. With our legs out, it was a red hot day of the year. Then afterwards, we got on the pitch, got back to the van. Just went in London for a few drinks, met up with a few United fans. They played Charlton the same day. They just got back. Like, obviously, they were at home, but their fans lived in London. I don't know if you remember Leeds and Bournemouth, when Leeds trashed Bournemouth. I think, well, Leeds got promoted at Bournemouth, and they had thousands of fans in Bournemouth, and they trashed the place, but on the way home, we were stuck in traffic on whatever, M1, M6. And so we were just crawling, again with our legs out of the van and on the motorway. Because it was roasting. Well, it was night time, but it was still warm. Just speaking to the Leeds fans, it was a good laugh.
Good stuff. Good stuff, Andrew.
Good banter.
Good banter, yeah, right. The good old days. And hopefully those away journeys will come back sooner rather than later, huh?
Hopefully, yeah. Yeah, definitely.
All right, buddy. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, no problem.
Appreciate it.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you for listening. If you'd like to hear more of our podcasts, please click on the red subscribe button on the bottom right-hand side. Thank you.